Sorry.
I just say everything that comes to mind. So, I'm in the Department of Agricultural Economics, and I was lucky enough to get to conduct the 2021 Equine Survey for the Kansas Horse Council and Kansas Department of Agriculture. And it's a redo of a survey that was done in 1996 because we needed newer information to represent our equine industry at for lobbying purposes and for just to show what a big part of the economy of Kansas the equine industry is. So, we wanted some data to back that up rather than just have anecdotal evidence, so we collected that with this survey. So this is just a brief outline of what we've got going on to show you from the survey. We're just having, these are preliminary findings. I'm gonna compile a report after this to go into a little bit more depth. This is going to give you the highlights of what we got out of the survey. So we'll hit those survey highlights. We'll talk about the equine population. We'll talk about the equine operation, who responded to the survey, what kind of activities we have that add value to our economy, and value-added trail. These activities here are more your competitions and rodeos, et cetera, shows. And then you have your trail adding value to your economy as well. Then we'll talk about our next steps. What we're going to do with our survey data. These are adorable and had to go in this presentation, frankly. So, comparison of our data that we had to 1996. So, for reference, we had the 1996 survey showed that we had 103,000 head in Kansas. We estimated from our survey sample an equine population in 2022 of about 70,000. So we are, whenever you do a survey, you have a sample of a population. And so you have to estimate what your total population is. And so our estimation was based on comparison of USDA numbers from the 1995 census and the 2017 census, how those had changed. And so that's how we estimated the 70,000 head for this population. What we found was about 259 million value for, that's for the actual horses and donkeys and all other equine. And that compares to 183 million from the 1996 survey. We found almost $1 billion worth of land building and fence, or buildings and fence. Those little asterisks mean that the 1996 numbers, the 681 million for 96, includes land, building, and fence. We did not ask about land values in the 2021 survey. So our 800 million does not include land values. So with the way that land values have increased over time, this number here, if we include land values in there, in a report I made with a lot of assumptions, add in some land value in the final report, but I didn't want to present that right here. So instead, but that number in the final report, including women, may wind up being significantly higher than what this is. So when you see the final report and you see that number, you're like, that's not what she presented. That's why. So our other capital equipment, what that other capital equipment includes, and we gave this on the survey, we said, now this includes gates, hot walkers, treadmills, trailers, tractors, trucks, tack, and any other miscellaneous equipment, and anything else you can think of, okay? So we just gave those kind of as examples and said includes, but not limited to, these are dollars that are spent in the equine industry. So this is equine operations, what they're spending, and this is money spent on employees. Okay? $160 million for the operation, and about $13 million for labor. Slightly higher here on 2021 on the operating expenditures, and a little bit lower on labor. So we're working with fewer people.
With many things, probably automation, never know. Also drop in population of our, potentially drop in population of our equine
numbers.
Like I say,
that number may be subject to change. I've had some new information come in that what we had when I put this together, what I had was National Ag Statistics USDA numbers for comparison to estimate a population. And now I know that the American Horse Council did a survey back in 2017. And so I'm going to see if they've got some historic data that I can use as a basis to estimate what our population might be. And so that number may be subject to change as well. Okay? This is providing really good reference points, though, just FYI. But I would definitely encourage taking a look at the final report. So whenever you look at a sector, there is a certain way to analyze the economic impact, and it's called social. Do I need to memorize one?
Yeah.
It's an economic impact modeling, and the particular software that we use to arrive at these numbers is called an implan model. Okay? It's commonly accepted that frequently done in economic impact studies, people will use what's known as implan, and that's just how they refer to it. Anyway, so what I'm showing here, I'll show the individual steps, and then final report, I will show the individual steps of how we got here. But the culmination of an implan model is what does your sector contribute to the economy that you're looking at? So we're looking at the Kansas economy. What does the equine sector contribute to the Kansas economy? So we have three different effects that a sector will have on the economy. The direct effect is consumer dollars spent in the equine industry, okay? So dollars that we spend as consumers when we go and we buy feed, we go and we buy tack, we go and we buy things for our equine. So that's our direct effect. The indirect effect is whenever you buy feed, somebody has to provide the feed store with that feed. So the feed store buys from a producer to get their grain. So that indirect effect is those companies' dollars spent company to company. Make sense? Thank you, guys. I appreciate you giving me feedback on that. I hate blank stares. I'm always sitting there. Do I need to go on? Okay. So the next effect, the third effect, is the induced effect. And that effect is, so all of this is kind of, as you can tell, trickle down. But so the induced effect is when you as a family work in the equine industry and you earn money. Your dollars that you're earning from the equine industry, you go out to dinner way back. So that's the induced effect, is the households that work in the equine industry, or and that they may work in this sector in the inner company, they may work directly for the equine industry, but they're getting deriving income from the equine industry, and they're spending it in other stores. Okay? That makes sense? That still contributes, as the equine sector, to the Kansas economy. So that's your induced effect. All right. So, columns, we've got employment. So that's number of folks. So the equine industry directly can support about 1,850 people. Indirectly, about 333, and induced is about 417. So we arrive at total effects, really we'll probably just hit the bottom line on the rest of these, and be about 2,600 people. So for every person that is employed in the equine industry, it can support 0.41 more. Okay? Jeez. Getting happy on the buttons. So, with those people employed in the sector, then they earn about $107 million. So for every dollar spent on employment, 57 more cents is contributed to the Kansas economy. And then we have total value added is $150 million. Total output, and this is the big one, so the big contribution is $208.5 million to the Kansas economy from the equine sector. So for every dollar spent in the equine sector, it contributes about 85 more cents. Okay? Making sense? All right. So now we're going to get down to analyzing, looking at some of the data that came in. Okay, we've talked about the dollars and the economic contribution. Now let's look at what we sampled and see what we came up with and figured it was a representative population of Kansas. And I'll show you how I arrive at that this sample is a representative sample of the equine industry in Kansas. All right, so we've got per county, we've got average. I know on your handout it says 50 light horses, and that's about right. It depends on my rounding. This day I was rounding down, so we have about 50 draft, 50 light horses, 2 draft, 3 pony, and 6 other equine, which are your burros and donkeys, etc. So for every respondent, we had about 6 head of equine, and the average age of our equine was about 12 years. There's another way that you can look at it. You can kind of see how the distribution of the average equine across the state. And so you can see these little red dots. The size of the red dots tells you the average number of equine per county. Okay. And you can see Hamilton is kind of your biggest out here. That's the most, highest average of equine. And then generally your dots start to get bigger as you come east across the state. So you tend to have more equine towards the eastern side of the state. It's basically what that comes up with. So I throw this in because we're going to break down in comparison to the 1996 report. The 1996 survey showed number of equine by crop reporting district. And so I'm going to show you that as well. But for you to know what that means, I need to show you a map what the crop reporting districts are. So these heavy black lines outline the crop reporting districts that have been assigned. still sticks out as one of your big counties. That county in and of itself is what I would say is representative of the type of ranching, farming ranching in the eastern part of the state. So that makes sense to me that there's a lot of horses there.
So here is a graph of the age distribution, and so 60% of our sample equine fell in the 5 to 19 year range. I like to say they're middle aged like me. I may not be quite that spry. I might fall a little bit closer to the 20 to 29. But so that's our distribution. So I'd say that, you know, that's not young breaking horses. You got good juicing. That's your good juicing ages. Most of the sample were quarter horses. We had some other light horses, paints, Arabians, and go on down to Suffolk. We had a lot of folks who, we have this category called light horse other, and then we had some equine other, just some other categories, and didn't have a chance before this to break those down because we had so many people putting their equine in the other category because they wanted to be really specific on as to the breed. Rather than say, like, if they were half quarter, half paint, or something like that, they wanted to be that specific instead of just lopping them into one of the other categories. And we have it in the final report, as in we will go ahead and we'll pull all of that out of those other categories and put them into the breeds that they need to go, so that we have very minimal numbers in our others. So this is how our light, the categorized as light, were distributed. Again, heavy in Butler County. Then our draft equine. This is how those were distributed across the state for the sample. I have a few out there.
Do any of you guys have draft horses or
what draft do you cross?
Yeah, across.
Yeah, I'm an other.
Awesome.
But we do have a couple shires today at our draft horse competition. So.
Good. Do you guys have light horses or mm-hmm. are y'all quarter?
Predominantly.
Okay. I shed paint for a long time. I rode quarters up until I started into showing. We rodeoed for a long time, and I decided I wanted to get into the really expensive side. Yeah, I thrilled my dad to no end, let me tell you. But then I got into the paint world.
Here's our pony distribution across the state.
And I don't know about you guys, but I was honestly...
The Thomas County ponies.
I was surprised by the numbers.
She's from Thomas County.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I was surprised by it too, honestly.
Yeah. I was like, wow, there's a lot. Yeah. Which is cool. I love the fact that we have such, and that kind of contributes to believing that it's a representative sample because we have, you know, we have, because I do think that probably heavy presence of white horses tends, is probably a good example of the population. But I think that we've got those others, and the way that it's distributed across the state, that we've got so many responses from so many counties. And we'll eventually, I'll get to the point where you can see where all the respondents came from. But we're across the state, and so I really feel like these sample numbers are representative of the equine population in Kansas.
The primary use,
almost 2,000 are personal, but we have a lot in radio, a lot in show, got a lot. It's nowhere near like a production operation, but it does give them that good feels. And so I think that if you have any kind of connection with that, and if you have any ability, I really think that that's an area that we could exploit and really, really increase our contribution to the economy as the equine sector is through agritourism. You know, I understand that there are a lot of insurance complications that we have to go through, but I believe, and let's see, where's lessons? Yes. So we've got folks giving lessons, and I can't believe that the insurance issues with lessons would differ tremendously from the insurance issues with agritourism. So I think that we might could find some synergies there.
Yeah, I'm eager to kind of explore that as well. And actually on that point, that's a conversation that each community could be having when they're looking at their joint planning and zoning opportunities to develop further by creating this ranchette segment that would incorporate the equine into the urban zone to provide all kinds of, you know, it's therapeutic, you've got your lessons, it gives you the green space, it develops that, you know, you got your 30-somethings, it attracts them to your community.
Yes.
To stay. I presented this to Emporia, Lyon County, as something they should be exploring. So, I mean, I really think if somebody jumped on that and created a model or template, which is kind of fashioned after, there's, I think it's Norco, California, that has a community built around that. If we got something in Kansas like that,
I think you should be able to find some federal funding for that too, because the terms that you use, like green space,
yes,
and,
yeah,
and rural development, things like that, they're happy to throw money at those types of opportunities.
I would love to have further conversation from all of us brainstorming ways to get that word out.
Love that idea.
We're on the farm tours for that agritourism, our ranch.
Miami County.
In Miami County.
Awesome.
And
they're a leader.
They do that spring and fall. They'll have, the county actually produces the spring one. And we're one of the few that educate on the horses too at our place. So the others, most of them on there, you know, are not. But
right.
That would be, if you jumped into that area, you know, getting in on the meetings,
mm-hmm.
yeah, that
yeah.
you know, get in on the meetings of those.
Yeah.
So we've got one we're involved in for Mother's Day weekend,
okay.
And like I said, the county, Miami County, is producing it. So they've got a lot of contacts. They're very, the gal that's in charge of it's very nice to work with and
excellent.
Stuff. So
excellent.
You know, that might be a contact.
Yeah.
So on a practical note, is it a giant pain in your tuchus? Is it a pain in your hiney doing it, or is it, do you feel like it's worth it?
Well, I love education, so
okay.
for me, it's not a pain.
Awesome.
Because we educate them on where their beef comes from. We take them out in, we take them on a flatbed trailer, and we take them to our little feedlot and show them that. They get to go interact with the goats. And the chickens, and
perfect.
They see
perfect.
The eggs, they can gather eggs too. We actually have a barrel horse, little barrels made, and so that we don't have the liability of putting people on the horses,
uh-huh.
but they can ride a saddle. So,
yeah.
And we pull it around. It's really
it's
cute. They're
cute.
Here actually at Equifest. They're sitting around for people to get on. They can actually feel what a real saddle feels like. So our whole thing is about education. It costs us money. It'd be fun if we had some help with that, because it takes all the thing that you spend the money on
yeah.
is the having to have enough workers.
Yeah,
because
the labor.
So if you yeah the labor part of it. So if you had
yeah.
some help with that, that would really help us be more excited and other places
yeah.
too.
And you're creating jobs.
Right.
Yes,
exactly.
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah. We'd be
as well.
Exactly.
Yeah. So
we've got people that, you know, they'd love to, that, you know, if we'd hire them to
uh-huh,
do that
uh-huh.
stuff, we got lots of stuff. And so they get to interact with the horses. And actually, something we started last year, you talking about horses, you know, therapeutic places. We
mm-hmm.
had Living Life Ranch out of Gardner bring their horses, and they
oh,
actually
good.
Gave some sessions. And you would not believe.
They were huge. They were packed.
Yes.
They were packed.
I would think so.
And this, and like this spring, on Sunday, we've got one of our kids is loves training horses. Or we call him our kid.
Yeah.
You know, we claim him. And he's going to, him and our son will do demonstrations, and they'll bring colts up and stuff, and they'll have that going all day in our arena. So
awesome.
Our arena's right by the store. Everything's very handy.
Yeah, yeah.
But if we had money help, we could do even more, because we've got antique equipment sitting around.
We've got a nice model that,
yeah.
Well, that's
that,
what I was thinking.
That they become a resource then that I can send people to.
Yes.
If they are, if they're remotely interested in developing something,
yeah.
Bill and Jana have the experience to
yep.
share with them.
We need to
so.
We need to figure out a way to get funding to them.
That would
it
help
sounds
us
like
do
we've
a
got
lot.
That model set up kind of going
yeah.
as we want. Maybe throw in some petting stuff with
yeah.
the minis and things like
yeah.
that. And then
we've and we've already got the we've already got a mini mule and a mini pony, and they can feed, interact. Yeah. So
this is very exciting to me. I think this is super fun. We've gotta start looking into
yeah.
some funding for that. But yeah, I love that idea. And
yeah, and you could bring Justine wanna bring people like she just said, people out
yeah.
and see the layout, and then the equipment someday needs to be labeled. You know, we've got some old plows and some different
mm-hmm.
things that
which is
kids
kind of
aren't
what
going
to
see.
We've tried to set that up here at some time, and it never. Getting all the players and all the pieces in place is always a challenge. So,
right.
But the, yeah, absolutely. Education and agritourism are a big component that helps draw the enthusiasm and interest that then comes in subsequently,
yes.
supports it even further, perpetuates it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It will become a self-feeding cycle.
Yes.
Yeah.
We've had a lot of people calling wanting to learn to do small acres. I got people calling and said, hey, somebody
exactly.
gave me your number. You can help us set up what chickens we should have and
yeah.
stuff like that, which all just helps with horses.
It's all support.
And,
oh,
yeah.
completely. Entirely.
You know, because
yep.
those people would come for lessons or whatever, you know, they're loving
one
the horses.
Another.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, thanks. I appreciate you adding me into that. Yeah, that's very helpful. Yeah, that was... When I started looking at these numbers, that was something that I was like, oh man, we gotta get on that.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so back to our value. These are numbers from a sample. Before I showed you numbers for what we were estimating for the population, these are the averages that we came from the sample. Our registered average is about $30,000, and our grade is about $7,000.
And that's per head, the value.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, that's the average across the sample person. Yes.
Yeah.
So that's average
yeah.
per head. And so median, what median means is if you array all of your responses from, do y'all know what median means? Okay. And I won't go into it. So median was 12,000 for registered, 4,000 for grade. Mode was, I assume you know what mode is if you know what median is. So mode is the most commonly occurring response. And so it was 10,000 for registered and 5,000 for grade. And I would say, you know, once you put them all together, then you kind of get arrive at an actual number, because more than likely, because it's real easy for, I see this a lot, you know, folks go, about 10,000.
Yeah.
Anyway, averages for the sample of acreage is about 317 for equine operation. The average building value is about $137,000. And other capital equipment that we talked about earlier is about $60,000 per operation. So, breaking it down into categories, so we had about 192 responses that said that their building value was between $10,000 and $50,000. That was our biggest number of responses, and 37%. Said that their operation was between 0 and 25%, or 25 acres. The other capital equipment, again, we're kind of coming into that between 10 and 50. You know? So 219,000 said that their other capital equipment fell in the 10,000 to 15,000. So there's a lot of information on the survey that I wanted to trailering was our biggest category. That's where the most dollars flowed through. So the reason that I stacked these is because, as we talked about the economic impact, those expenses are still dollars spent in the equine industry. The income also in the equine industry. So we want to combine those two to see what a total outlay from the sample is. Okay. So biggest category was trailering at about $3,500,000. So the way that income and expense is distributed is shown in this graph. So all of these categories will equal 100%. What each column shows you is the distribution between income and expense. So, hay, 13% of the dollars in hay were income. 87% of the dollars for hay was expense. I'm not going to go through all the categories. Y'all are like, thank you, because we can read. So they are in your handout, so you can look at that. This is just a breakdown of the averages. Rather than looking at total outlays, we're looking at average outlay per operation. Okay? Same categories. And then, so training, we have, now on this one, the purple is in. And the yellow is expense. I apologize for switching that on you. Just make sure you're still awake. So this comes back to the conversation we were just having as far as insurance hurdles. So these folks that are training and riding lessons, yeah, we need to talk. They've obviously got some waivers and stuff in place that we can start from. Now we're going to talk about folks that are employed by the equine operations. 38% of the employees were part-time, 31% were full-time, 26% were seasonal part-time, and 6% were seasonal full-time. Average employee salaries for full-time is pretty good. It's almost $54,000 from our sample. So we asked the respondents what was their role, what role were they completing the survey as? And 65% of them said that they were completing it as an individual. 27% said that they were a household with multiple equine owners in it. 8% said they were a business owner, which translates to, I'll show you in a second. 98% said that they owned equine in Kansas, and 20% said that they owned equine outside of Kansas. So, largely female respondent base. I see this a lot. We tend to be better survey takers. So the other, and then we've got just a wide variety. This is just did not answer the question, and so we kind of throw that one out. But these are so largely 56 to 60 was where most of our respondents fell, or the biggest number of single category respondents. 75% of the respondents said they did not have an equine industry occupation, but 21% did. And their self-described role, 88%, which kind of goes along with this, 88% said they were owners and 12% said that they were suppliers in the equine industry. So I like the fact that we've got, and again, going back to that representative sample, I think that that's probably a pretty good representation of what the distribution of owners and suppliers is actually in Kansas.
sorry, I was getting a really bad cramp in my leg.
Oh, no.
We can probably guess on the guest ranch that it's a husband and wife since it looks equal. And,
yeah. Which, if it had been compared directly to 96, it might have been a different, I mean, yeah, because we've lost the racing, which used to be a significant component in our state.
That has a huge impact.
Yes.
When you can't do it legally, you're going to have a drop off.
Which, it's still legal, we just don't have the track support.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
It's not as desirable to get other people to be on board with that.
Yeah. And that holds
and
true in the arena
happens.
Infrastructure world too, the
it,
venue world.
Yep.
So.
Amen to that.
I'll tell you all this in a minute. So again, this is our response distribution by crop reporting district. Shows that we do have a good number of responses all across the state. Do have more responses in the eastern part of the state. Here you can see that response distribution broken down by category. The only Kiowa, Comanche, Wichita, Lane, and Decatur were the only counties. Thanks suggesting that we didn't have any responses in, and Justin did a fantastic job of throwing at people. I was like, man, if I had money, I'd hire you for all of my surveys. She beat the bushes. It was awesome.
She did a good job.
Exactly. It also took a lot of board members and friends last minute to try to pull those last ones.
Right. So, but I think that also provides information supporting a representative sample case. So this is picture feature owner, but our typical owner for. Or she might be an owner right now, you don't know. But our typical owner from the survey respondents was, she was female, 44.06 years old, with an average income from the equine industry of about $17,500. Role in the equine industry was an owner rather than supplier. They owned equine in Kansas largely and experienced
Yes was purple, no, and the yellow. And then we have organization number, yes, but we have lots of no's in these organizations, and so like this is where I think that we're missing some organizations listed. Not sure what they're. We've got a participatory group. So that bodes well for the future. And if they participate in, or when they participate in the events, 64% can participate as often as they can, more than 3 times a year. Again, establishing, we've got a participatory group. We can definitely, if we get them focused in the right direction. And I think there's probably more people than we know of, like you out there, who would love to teach and educate and share their horses, their equine, with other people. So, miles traveled to the events. This kind of surprised me how far people will go. So 20% said that they'll go between 10,000 and 20,000 miles a year. Yeah. And overnight stays, 35%, again, contributing to the economy with those overnight stays. 35% said that hotel, VRBO, Airbnb, or a motel. So moving on to trail aspects, we asked them how they picked their parks. The number one was that park was well groomed. Frequency of riding the equestrian trails in Kansas, 15% said that they would do it 1 to 4 times per year, but 7% said 20 or more times. And again, organized trail ride attendance, 47% was as often as I can, more than 3 times a year. Trail ride usage, 45% was day use, and then miles traveled, again, kind of surprising, 31% was over 1,000 miles. Just some miscellaneous information. Yeah, you could tell I really like this picture. It got in there twice because it's just so cute. And they make me smile every time. So 12% of the respondents said that they volunteered at a park. 89% said that they will want to try new trails. And on the other side of that, 31% said we need to get more education out there. So, got some people who want to learn too. A lot of trails. And Canopolis is our leader with 208 responses.
Wendy will be excited to see that. She may already know that though.
But still, we've got, let's see, I don't think didn't have anyone with zero.
What I see the relevance to that graph is that it's where our backcountry horsemen are the strongest.
Yeah.
Those are the predominant areas. So it really, is a testament to their contribution to the trails.
Excellent. So this is a chosen distribution of where those folks volunteer, what trails they volunteer. Erie State has 16%. So, finally, the next steps are compiling the final report, and it will entail more detailed information on the implant analysis that we've done. I kind of did this survey before. My implant guy came through for me before, so I was able to give those numbers to you guys. And we'll probably go into a little bit more depth, like you were talking about, in comparison to the 1996 survey, and break some of our numbers out from this survey, compare it to those, just so you have a kind of a bad benchmark. How we're adding 85 cents for every dollar that is spent in the equine industry, we're almost doubling every dollar. So if we grow that industry, we're growing twice the economy. Then we're growing the economy by, we're doubling the economy, our contribution. So I think it's incredibly encouraging, the data that we got from the survey. And I want to say thank you, many, many thanks to Justine for all of her hard work and help and beating the bushes and getting responses, and to Janelle for all of her marketing help and contribution from Kansas Department of Agriculture. And see if I have any questions. That's what I'm like. Hopefully I can confuse everybody.
Thank you, Leah.
You're very welcome. And if you guys, think up some questions that you want to ask them later, or if you want to email me, let me, here's my email. And I am on it all the time. So that's probably the easiest way you can hold me.
Fantastic.
Perfect.
Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you for the demo.